and welcome on this beautiful Sunday morning. Be sure to read the bulletin, there is a correction. Naomi Circle meets on Monday, May 23rd, that's tomorrow, but they meet at 5 o'clock, not 1 o'clock, we've got a little typo. The Pine Perennial Sale is June 4th, please take a look at all the things that would be greatly appreciated if you would donate. It's a good time to go through all the stuff that we've been collecting in your garage and your basement in terms of pots and that type of thing. Or for books, and that type of thing you'd like to do. Everyone is welcome here, no matter where you are on your faith journey. And everyone is welcome to community. And today we offer a special welcome to the referred home of Kathy Green, so you can talk to her at coffee.
For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Paul assures us, when we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive together with Christ, nailing the record of our sins to the cross. Jesus says to you, your sins are forgiven. Be at peace and tell everyone how much God has done for you.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And share a sign of God's love with one another.
The first First lesson is from Proverbs, chapter 8, verses 1 through 4, 22 through 31. Does not listen, call, and does not understanding, raise her voice. On the heights, beside the way, at the crossroads, she takes her stand. Beside the gates in front of the town, and at the entrance of the portal, she cries out, "To you, O people, I call, and my cry is to all that live. The Lord created me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of long ago. Ages ago, I was set up, at the first, before the beginning of the earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no springs abounding with water. Before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. When he had not yet made earth and fields, or the world's first bits of soil. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep. When he made the firm the skies above. When he established the fountains of the deep. When he assigned to the sea its limits, so that the waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the fountains of the earth. Then I was beside him, like a master worker, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world, and delighting in the human race." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You, whose glory is chanted above the heavens, above the mouths of infants and children, you have set up
in their courses.
What are mere mortals that you should be mindful of them? Human beings that you should care for them?
Yet you have made them little less than divine. With glory and honor you crown them.
You have made them rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet.
All flocks and cattle, even the wild beasts of the field,
the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the paths of the sea.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The second lesson is from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to his grace and we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces an endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
From a Jewish background to become Christians. Rather, They were coming from backgrounds that had a whole host of gods and idols that they worshiped. And so to make the transition happen, a lot of the newer Christians who were leading the way allowed them to understand God as three gods. As a God called the Father, another God called Jesus Christ, and another God called the Holy Spirit. So eventually what we had to do is begin to realize that these three, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are really a revelation of a God for our sake. And so we began that in that day, and today when we begin to look at seeing that Trinity in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, that we bless our gathering, that we begin a sermon, that we conclude our worship with, is a reminder of literally how God has come to us. God entered into our lives as the creator of all things. God came into our lives in the first two chapters of Genesis as creator. But then, beginning with Genesis chapter 3, it was God who chases after us until he finally catches us with the presence of Jesus Christ, taking the entire load of Scripture to finally bring us to the reality that we cannot by our own reason or strength do anything except acknowledge the fact that we are falling far short of the mark. And so into our lives comes a Redeemer that brings us back to a loving Father who is awaiting us, very much like the story of the prodigal son. And the way in which this is revealed to us, even to today, is through what is called the Spirit of Truth, the Holy Spirit. And so we come to know God as choosing to reveal himself to us in ways that we can understand, and even today we struggle with all of the presence of God in our lives and the depth and breadth of the ways in which God comes into our lives. Let's push that a little bit this morning. Now, I'm sure you have received these, as I did a couple weeks ago. It's usually a 4x6 postcard, and on that postcard says, "Congratulations! You have just won one of three prizes. Either it'll be a cruise, a flat screen TV, or $500 in cash. All you have to do is come to the dealership with your coupon. The small print is you'll have to make a down payment on a car." Strings attached. We get used to that. We have said there is no free lunch. We know we can ask the question, yeah, right, what's the catch? When we're offered a deal and it's too good to believe, what's the catch? We keep looking for what is it that we have to do in order to get what they are offering. And that's perhaps why it becomes difficult for us to comprehend fully what Paul is saying in that second lesson, that last verse, where God has poured into our hearts love through the Holy Spirit. God didn't say, raise your hand if you are eligible. Paul didn't say that God was looking for a few chosen people that he felt merited love. God poured love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. In other words, there is no better, no worse. All receive love from God. That's a powerful statement. And it's even more powerful when we understand from whom it comes. Romans, written by this gentleman by the name of Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament. Paul, who grew up in a strong Jewish family. Paul, who studied and is probably the greatest scholar that we have in the New Testament, and perhaps even in the Old Testament, who knows that Torah, who knows the scriptures of his people by memory, who knows the laws, and not only all of those 600 plus laws and requirements, but also knows the reason why he lived that life, knowing that this is the way in which he gets to have a right relationship with God. Why? Because he has dotted every I and crossed every T in his spiritual walk. But he is brought to grips with the reality that what he thought was right in life was pulling him away from a relationship with God, not deeper into it. Because Paul begins his life in our presence as the key persecutor and prosecutor of all those Jews who are now calling themselves Christian, going after them. He went after Stephen, and Stephen became a martyr as Paul held the robes of those who are going to stone Stephen. It is Paul, at that time Saul, who was on the road to Damascus to arrest Jews become Christians in Damascus, take them back to Jerusalem, and have them sentenced to death. And it's on that road that he discovers where he has missed the mark in his life. For it is on that road that he is blinded by the Lord, and he hears the word, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" And he comes to know who Jesus Christ is. And so when he says, loud and clear, that God pours love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, he is speaking of one who realized he was so far away from any right or proper or whatever relationship we want to call it that he had with God, that he, the least of which, deserved any kind of love and forgiveness. He understood, therefore, the depth and breadth that God was willing to go to bring us back, to bring us back with a sense of equality. There is no better, no worse. All share in the same gift of love. And that's what Paul is delivering to us in those basic words in our lesson, our second lesson today, through the Spirit of Truth. The Spirit of Truth who tells us whose we really are and what we need to do about that ownership, that claim of God upon our hearts and lives. Story is told the first day of school where a teacher is registering her students coming in. And these two little girls came in, and what, they were holding each other's hands, and one of them proved to be the spokesperson for the two of them. He said, "Hi, we are sisters." And the teacher looked at them and she said, "Okay." He said, "I was born on April 8th and my sister was born on April 20th. And we were both 7 years old." He looked at him and said, "Okay, how does that happen?" He said, "Well, one of us is adopted." "Well, which one?" "Well, we don't really know, because when we asked Mom and Dad about that, they said, you know, we loved you so deeply, and it was so precious for us to have the two of you that we forgot which one of you was adopted." Thus it is also with our God. God forgets who has stood up and really, we would say, truly deserves that gift of love. God treats us all, regardless of where we are in our life and what we bring before him, we are treated alike. Just before this passage from Romans that we had this morning, these three verses, Paul talks about the gift that was given to Abraham. Abraham was chosen by God to be the father of nations. And he was the father of the Hebrew community, the Jewish nation, the father of the Muslim community, and also our spiritual father in our walking Christianity. Why was he chosen? Because he found favor with God? Because he was an upright person? No, God chose him. God did the choosing, and it was not a matter of merit that got him there. And so we are reminded that he received that blessing to be a father, and we have also received a blessing. And the blessing is peace with God. And I've come to know what that peace means. It means we are forgiven. Think about that. Because the times that I need to be forgiven, I'm not thinking about asking forgiveness. It's when I step back and look at the places where I have caused soreness in somebody else's life, where I have been indifferent in the patterns in which I have lived my life, where I have not even lived up to what I have expected of myself. And at those points of frustration, the last thing I'm looking for is forgiveness. It's when I step back and look at that, I'm going, my God, where am I going? And realizing that I live in hope, that as I go through all of those shortcomings, my God is simply pouring a little bit of hope into my heart and life so that I come around to realizing, Bruce, no matter who you are, I still love you. I still love you, and I'm waiting for you to find those gifts and put them to use. I still love you. Keep looking. Keep looking. You're there. You're there for me. And we are together, not together in love. I lived through Hurricane Katrina down south. Didn't get much of it in Florida. But there's a story that hit the news that was carried into Florida from the Baton Rouge newspaper about a big buddy, they called him, because he was one of several members of teams that were going out looking for kids who were wandering around after the storm and no apparent parents around and wanted to make sure that they were taken care of and brought to shelters, safety. And it seems that this one buddy came across this little group of refugees. There was a six-year-old, and he was carrying his four-month-old brother with him, and behind him were several toddlers all the way down to age three, and she was hanging on to a 14-month-old. And there they were, walking along, six-year-old leading them. He came up to him and he said, hi there, what's your name? My name is Demont Love. Love. What a beautiful name for that particular moment in time. It seems what happened was, as their house was slowly giving in to the floods, a helicopter had come to rescue the family, but could only take the kids. And the pilot promised the parents that he would come back and take them to safety as well. But he never came back. And so these kids were dropped off at the heliport and were now looking for shelter in the midst of this horrific, horrific after effect of the hurricane. And it was at that shelter that they were finally reunited with their parents. Someone commented on the fact that surely they are going to be really traumatized by these events. And the big buddy said, I don't think so. What they found in the midst of all of that trial and tribulation and pain and uncertainty in their life was that love brought them through. More than just Demont love, their names also love. But there was a sense of presence there that brought them to safety. I want you to think about in the midst of the places in life where we need that particular ingredient in our living. It is perhaps where we grow a little bit impatient, but it's also the same place where we need persistence, where we strive to find where our God wants us to be. If we are in the midst of uncertainty, it is our God who is bringing us hope. If it is in the midst of affirmation where we can take what we have and bring it into the hearts and lives of others, so be it. It is our God who gives us the Spirit of truth to take us into all those places that we need to be. And it's up to us to recognize the word, the powerful word that Paul gives us in that last sentence of our lesson today. God has chosen to pour love into your hearts through the Holy Spirit, that He gave it, that He gave to you. Let's pray. Into this moment, Heavenly Father, we bring our thanksgiving. We thank you for revealing yourself to us in so many different ways. And we thank you especially today for that Spirit, that it would inspire us to take up that assurance that we have that we are yours, and to bring it back into our search for the gifts that we have that we can use to help make that difference that this community and this world really needs. It's in our hands, Heavenly Father, and you give us the guidance to use it. We pray in your son's name. Amen. Our hymn of the day.
Oh, yeah.
that we may come to the help of all in need through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Thank you.
Please stand. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Let us pray together. We give you
thanks, O God, that you make your home with us, bringing heaven to earth in this holy meal. Fill us with your Spirit as we go from here, that we may rightly cheers, tend to those in mourning and pain, seek in you in the nations, and bring to earth the presence of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and give you the Lord's face, shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Our sending song.